the only station that shines the light on the paranormal, Paramania Radio.
Old-time radio? Then join Paramania Radio each week as we present episodes of old broadcast radio programs from the past filled with mystery, suspense, drama, and the supernatural. Join us every Saturday at 11 p.m. Eastern for old-time radio.
The views expressed and the opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Paramania, its affiliates, or its sponsors. Join us where we talk about hot topics in the paranormal field and share tales of an investigator. Find out about lessons learned. Learn about the do's and don'ts of investigation. Find out all about the truth. This show is hosted by Russ Stiver. It's time for Attery's Drain.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Batteries Drained. We had a little bit of a technical hiccup there at the beginning, but got on nonetheless. Couple new announcements tonight. I know last week we had had to cancel the show because of the weather that had happened that went through Indiana, Kentucky, and some really bad weather. And that leads me to my first announcement. Chris Deadman, who actually hosts another show on here, Dead Time, on Sundays, on May 4th, from 7 p.m. to 3 a.m., he is having a paranormal lockdown at the, I believe it's pronounced Archaea. Center, which is also known as the Cardome Center in Georgetown, Kentucky. It is actually the same place he held his Halloween con in 2011. It's a fantastic location. It's $25 a person, and all proceeds goes towards tornado victims. Jenny's actually pushing something around on her website as well. It's a benefit that goes towards the children in Indiana and southern Indiana that were hit by the tornado, that devastating tornado that went through in Henryville, I believe it was. So if you know Chris or Jenny, you have them on your Facebooks, go ahead over, check it out. And if you want to volunteer, just get a hold of them and see what you can do. So that leads us right into our guest for tonight. You've seen him on the Paranormal Challenge. You might have seen him on a couple of YouTube videos. But we have Mr. Daniel Hooven with us tonight. Are you there with us, Dan?
Hey, how's it going, everybody?
Not too bad, sir. How about yourself?
I'm doing okay. Doing okay. Can't complain.
Good, good. How's the weather? What's that?
I just thought we're going up against the season premiere Ghost Avengers tonight.
Oh, yes, yes. Yeah, you know, you know what? But they're over in the Shanghai tunnels all the way on the West Coast. It's all right. I'm not worried about it. So how was the weather over in PA today? I know, like, out of nowhere today, we just got over here in Ohio. We just got a, you know, crap load of snow out of nowhere.
Yeah, you know, I was actually on the phone with Adam Kimmel, and all of a sudden, it's like a flash flood of snow. It stopped. I'm up in the area. So, yeah, of course, a little dusting, but been mild otherwise.
Well, you know how it is over here on the East Coast. We can go through all four seasons in one day. We had 70 degrees 2 days ago, and today we had snow, so.
I know. It's special, right?
Mm. Exactly. So why don't you go ahead and tell the listeners a little bit about yourself, you know, how you got involved with the paranormal, you know, your team a little bit, and things like that.
Yeah. Actually, November 2010, I actually was never, it's ironic, you know, I'm a huge Ghostbusters fan. I was actually born the day it came out, loved the movie, just actually recently ran into the actual Ghostbusters firehouse building in New York last weekend. It was interesting.
Awesome.
but I never really got into it. That's the thing. Never really into the whole paranormal thing. November 2010, I remember Adam and I went to college together, and we had some experiences in a fraternity house that we ran. and he got real into it. And, you know, Adam loved the ghost hunting shows, loved all that, but he got into it himself, and he goes, you know what, I want to try it for myself. Because his thing was, they're entertaining, but they could be faking it, you know, and that's what most people think when they watch it. So he went out there doing it for himself. He's a doer more than a watcher, really, in most aspects of life. And November 2010, his Facebook status, when they said he was going to go confront the devil in Iowa. And I'm like, I didn't know what was going on. So I'm like, what's in Iowa? And he told me about Villisca, the Villisca Axe Murder House. And it sounded interesting to me. I was pretty bored with everything. I didn't have much going on. You know, I had a job, girlfriend, standard, you know, stuff you're supposed to do when you're 26, I guess. But I saw that, talked a little bit about it, but I'll go because he asked if I wanted to go. I asked, you know, hey, if you can use a third guy, I'll go. And I went on my very first paranormal investigation, the Villisca Axe Murder House, in November 2010. I had a lot of fun with that. Scared the hell out of me when I realized what was actually going on around me. You know, the most terrifying part of it was interesting when I first heard the voices, but the most terrifying part was obviously a post-evidence review when you heard stuff going on around you.
Of course.
And, I mean, you know how it is. You think everything, oh, this place is, you know, nothing here.
Yeah.
2 days later, you have your headphones on, you're like, oh my God, well, that's, you know, great to hear that going on. Not always bad, but, you know, we just did some evidence review, and, you know, we had the cameras down. We were talking in the distance, and I hear footsteps running by clear as day. I'm like, well, that's interesting. And since then, you know, we did, I know a place you frequent a lot. We went to Madison in March. Had a good time there. Nice place, actually. Very nice place. And then next, I know we ended up on that Paranormal Challenge show, and we've just been going ever since. You know, our YouTube just crossed over 90,200 views, I think. We finished pretty well off in that Shorty War thing, so it just became really an addiction, which is most paranormal people you talk to, you get taste, but you keep going and going, it just doesn't stop.
Exactly, it goes from a hobby to a passion, and it just goes from there.
Yeah, next thing I know, I quit my job, moved 400 miles, kind of focused on Resident Undead, and the product of just kind of, you know, seeing everything. And, you know, life's definitely not as normal as it used to be, but it's a lot more fun.
Oh, definitely. You know what? When you always throw something like that in there, it always gets very interesting, needless to say.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. You never know what's going to happen. Like, we were at Pennhurst 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
We filmed an episode on Pennhurst State School. You know, we were in Manhattan last week doing some stuff. We were at Trans Allegheny, you know, yesterday. It's just, it's been, the past year and a half, it's been an absolute adventure. I don't regret any of it, you know. I really don't. It's just been crazy. Been a blessing, really.
That's awesome. I mean, definitely when you can have the experiences like you guys have, you know, it's definitely a blessing, like you said, you know, to be able to have a whole new world opened up for you. That's definitely awesome for you guys. And, you know, I jumped on your YouTube page a little bit ago, and you guys have a laundry list, a lot of places that I've been to as well. You know, Hillview Manor, Ohio State Reformatory, Mansfield Reformatory, Bobby Mackey's, Trans-Allegheny, Prospect Place, you know, of course, a place very near and dear to my heart, Madison Seminary. You know, but also you've been to Visquilla, Old South Pittsburgh, USS Salem, which you guys just did last month, right?
Yeah, USSM, that was actually a big shout-out, big thank you. RTS Paranormal, actually, they run the show over there. And real great people, very nice team, probably one of the most well-organized groups I've ever seen as far as it comes to managing the property. Usually it's just a property owner, but in this case it was their whole team managing it. And they, you know, can't give enough thanks to them for everything. They did RTS Paranormal, a very good group of people. And that was awesome on the battleship. That was just, it's actually... You know, it was the first battleship with live ammo, and there was a lot of interesting things there. A lot of the buttons are still live after all these years. But that was actually one of my favorite trips. That was one of my favorite trips. It was during the playoff game with the Broncos in New England. We were T-bowing everywhere. I mean, busting the locals a little bit. USS Salem was cool. Well, we'll talk about this with Hospital. If you ever get a chance to get down there, Cindy and Doug, the proprietors that run the place, they're real into what we're into as far as the whole role-playing and reenactment. You need a prop, they have it.
Awesome.
Genuinely, I can see the passion in their eyes, but they love it. And the cool little thing is for, like, you know, an extra $15 or whatever it is, which is a steal, you can actually rip you some DVDs of their security cameras that watch the place while you investigate. So it's a cool place. Definitely, if you get a chance to get down there, it's awesome.
Yeah, we were actually supposed to go down there next month. But I decided, actually, we're actually heading down to a couple team members are actually heading down to Waverly Hills on Tuesday to go down there.
Oh, yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, that's good. I always want to get down there.
It's going to be my second time back. I actually went right around the same time last year. We actually were there last year right on St. Patrick's Day. And, of course, you know, we had to stand out in the parking lot and do a salute of whiskey for for St. Patrick's Day because, you know, it's just how it is. But, you know, there's some good activity down in Waverly still. You know, I'm really excited to get back down there and go down there and check it out. Now, for a lot of people that don't know, you guys were on Paranormal Challenge at Rolling Hills Asylum, which I'd been there before. I've met Sharon, fantastic woman, love her to death. And you guys were up against an all-female team. I can't remember, the name's escaping me right now.
Mm-hmm.
What was the team that you were up against?
Paranormal Expeditions.
That's right, that's right. It was an all-female team. How was that experience for you guys? We're getting to work with Zach and, you know, the guest judges and things like that. You know, how was that for you guys?
It was interesting, you know, it was kind of a double-edged sword. I mean, honestly, the show itself, while it was a neat concept, I think theoretically when you turn the paranormal into a challenge, you're kind of failing right there. But I think that's why also Zach or whoever the producers were smart enough to indicate categories that were tangible. You can't judge evidence, you know. It's like you can say that they've had a personal experience, but you have nothing to base that on except your integrity and your word. So they were smart enough to include stuff like teamwork, equipment, technology, you know, historical knowledge. And so we had to balance that. It was a balancing act because, you know, you really film for 4 hours, you know, as far as investing. So, I mean, realistically, what are you going to get done in 4 hours, you know? We were really pushing for intelligent responses. And the experience, it was good. I mean, it was good. Zach was a nice guy. You know, this might speak to the paranormal nerd inside of me, but I was more excited than Gary Galka. He was one of our judges. I was more excited to meet him than anybody. And I think I might have offended David Schrader because I didn't know who he was, but I just really wanted to talk to Gary. You know, I called him, and I told him he was like the Thomas Edison of the paranormal. And, so, I mean, Patrick Burns, nice guy. I didn't get a lot of interaction with him. They were busy. It was cold. I don't blame them. Gary was a very nice gentleman, amazing person. I feel the privilege to chat with him and email every now and then about things. David, I'll be honest, now that I've been blunt about, I'm not a big fan. He was really offended, I think, that I didn't know about Darkness Radio. And I think he has a very large ego, which came into play in judging. Because the girls love them. What a lot of things, you know, we got a bad rap on our show, but what a lot of people didn't see was the constant flirting that was going on between David and the girls. And, you know, I understand. I think David saw, maybe he saw something that he thought might be marketable and started rolling towards that. It was very, but I personally thought it was unprofessional the way it went down, but we just kept our mouths shut because it didn't really, at that point, I was just like, whatever. Zach was probably he was more visible than most of the judges, actually. Nice guy. Definitely kind of tell there's a screen persona versus him. But, you know, nice guy. Production crew, amazing people.
Mm-hmm.
And the actual show, you know, like I said, it's frustrating because it was a great opportunity, but at the same time, you know, I see people still living off of that saying we were on Paranormal Challenge. You know, I like talking about it, but I'm never... You know what I mean? Like, we've moved on since then. We kept filming. That didn't defer us. I mean, I saw some things, and my personal things, get a little bit crazy after that. Teams were selling posters of themselves for, like, $10 or $15 at fair. They actually thought they were, like, a para-celebrity, per se. I mean, we have pictures and stuff, but we just give them out. I could really care less about the money part of it.
Of course.
I really, you know, we had them because people asked for them. People know if they want it, you know, every now and then, and I always giggle once or laugh if I get a request from Otter. I'm like, whatever. I'm like, take it. I'm like, God bless you, because I know, you know, I wouldn't ask for it from me. It was definitely an experience. I think we got a bad rap, especially me. The producers, they blatantly asked, you know, they wanted a bad guy, and I was willing to play that role. They were telling us how to stress the battle of sexes. Next year, Ray saying, you know, well, that guy is such a sexist. He made a funny remark. So it was TV. I
mean, it's all for the ratings.
Well, I will say, as much as everybody trashed the show, from what I understand, rating-wise, I know when by the fall, I think we were the series premiere, we pulled in about 750,000 people on the Nielsen ratings. The show did pretty well with rating. It actually finished ahead of Ghost Hunters. It was the second most watched paranormal show last year behind Ghost Adventures.
That's cool. Well, I think one of the big reasons about that is, too, is because Zach is such a big presence in the field right now.
Well, I think that's a good point. I think that's kind of where the show failed and what they were trying to do. Now, I think the reason the ratings were good on average is because you have 12 episodes versus the full season of Ghost Hunters, and you have a big boom out of the gate. I think one of the biggest mistakes was actually they thought Zach's fan base was going to buy into it a lot more than they did. I think the fan base came in, saw that it wasn't him and the crew, and turned away. You know, I personally think if they would have had Nick and Aaron on there, it would have had more of a connection. And that's just me looking at it from an entertainment aspect of it.
I think
the guest judges were a smart idea. I think having Gary Galka there to judge you on your technical savvy was genius because, I mean, what better man to judge you? You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, I also believe on one of the episodes they actually had Alexandria Holzer on as a guest judge.
Yeah.
And, I mean, Beanie. I mean, they've had several figures in the paranormal community on as guest judges.
Yeah, and I think, you know, maybe the judging, because you got to the average person, they don't know who they are. Like, I only knew about Alexandra Holzer because I love the Amityville Horror story, so I knew about her dad's name, and, you know, everywhere she goes, she talks about her father. So I knew who she was based off of that, and a lot of people didn't, but I think they should have been a little bit more consistent. I really, you know, I get a lot of flack for saying this a lot. Maybe if I'm personal about it, I don't think Dave Schrader's in any position to judge anybody on anything. I don't know. I think, you know, him and Zach go way back. I think it's a loyalty thing that Zach got him on that show. But to me, he is a very good promoter, a very good businessman. But as far as being in the paranormal, he really, you know, he's no Gary Galka. I mean, let's just put it that way, in my opinion. He hasn't really contributed anything that groundbreaking to the paranormal.
Of course, you know, and I'm gonna go right into another segue here. You guys are very, very active in the Youngstown area. You guys actually were one of the first teams into the Calvin Center out here in Youngstown. We CPRS actually had the pleasure, not myself personally, but several of my team members actually had the pleasure of working with you guys on the Zombinator film.
Yeah, Youngstown actually, and Youngstown, you know, it's a shame. It's such a cool area. We have a real good relationship with Sean Timms, the owner of the Calvin Center.
Mm-hmm.
And one of our friends tipped us up and said, hey, you know, we did this event here, mutual friends. You guys might want to check and set up a place out. So we actually filmed that day. It was 98 degrees. It was like last summer. It was during one of those like heat waves we got.
Of course.
we didn't know too much about the place except, you know, the basics of the Peabody Roth building. But Youngstown itself, historically, is pretty significant. You know, a lot of it about the Prohibition, the mobsters, and even, you know, some of the Titanic victims, I believe, are buried over there. You know, between the B&O Railroad and that German club. The Manicore, yeah. Great wings, by the way. Lies, you know, the Calvin Center. We've been working with the owner on the haunted overnights there. They've been some stuff happened, so nothing bad. They're just on hold right now. But you know, we've had some groups go in. I know one group is actually, I can't go into too much detail, but one group did get national television attention that will be coming to Youngstown.
Yep.
So the Calvin Center is going to be promoted soon on national television, and the place is active. We weren't involved in the Zombinator movie. We were involved with getting them there, and
yep.
We kind of built that relationship with them. And I know you guys were there filming some of the stuff. I think there's a personal connection between one of the producers and Eric. And even, you know, the cast members said they had some experiences down there. So the place is active, and we're really trying to work with Sean to get it more visible. We're going to. I mean, Sean's 100%. We're all in. We love the Calvin Center. We think it's going to be a real good catalyst for some stuff in Youngstown, because I think that in some ways Youngstown's been forgotten, and I don't think it should be like that. And
it really has.
Planetarium.
Youngstown is becoming a ghost town, unfortunately. I mean, I grew up in this area, and it's the same way with Warren. I mean, Warren's right down the street from me. It's another one of those, you know, mob town kind of things. You know, it's just they're because the businesses that are shipping out, we're losing more and more, you know, attractiveness to this area, and it's heartbreaking to see. But you know, I can understand the aspect of it. You know, I know when a couple of my group members were at the Calvin Center, we were just, they were messing around. I remember hearing them talk to me about it. They were kind of just messing around in the basement area, you know, waiting for to start filming, you know, in between breaks and everything. And they took out the ghost box and decided to do a ghost box session real quick. And actually, they were getting some pretty good responses from what they were saying.
Basement's active. The basement's one of the most active places. Now, the story behind it is that the owner, you know, it's a community center. I'm sure the basketball group in there, he rents businesses out of there. And there was a group of mediums that had mutual friends, and they said, hey, Sean, you know, we'd like to rent a room for once a month and just have our meeting here. It's one meeting with helping other ones, you know, learn the skill or understand it. You know, just one of those, you know, community things. Sean's a cool dude, man. He loves, you know, he loves the area, loves Youngstown, hometown boy, all about it. So he said, come on over, you know, take a look. And he goes, you know, honestly, if you guys just want a room once a month, I'm not going to charge you for it. You know, he's an honest man. He's like, if you want a room, I'm not using it. Take it for free.
Yeah.
You get a better price. Well, apparently the medium went into the basement and just stopped and said, they're all around us. And she said that there were so many spirits, they were lining the walls, and there was one negative presence on there being held back by other ones. And that she got into a physical confrontation with thin air, as Sean was describing it. But it looked like she was struggling with something.
Yeah.
And they ran out. They never came back. And Sean goes, you know, you offer somebody a room for free, and they say, no, something's going on.
Huh. That's really interesting. You know, I have to ask you. I know I've talked to Tom Cassell, of course, the owner of Madison. We're very close up there and everything. And I've gone to Madison over 25 times, and I've always had experiences when I've gone up there. How was it filming up there for you guys?
It was active. You know, it was active. It was, I remember I saw an old video there. I forget who the group's name was. I want to say Ravencrest. I forget who. It was on
yes.
YouTube, and it was probably the best orb I've ever seen in my life, where it really starts manifesting into something in front of the camera, and the camera goes out.
And just disappears. Yeah.
Disappears, yeah. I'm not a big orb guy, you know. People always tell me I miss orbs on my pictures that I take. I'm like, no, that's just the result of a cheap digital camera. That's just dust.
Exactly.
I will say the most compelling orbs I've ever seen were from Madison, where they were physically just not possible with the way where they were moving. It was a good energy, you know. The thing I like, and you know, we do go to the bad places, but some of these places like Madison, not every paranormal place is bad energy. In fact, I'd say the majority, probably 90% of paranormal locations are positive energy.
They just get that rap to kind of, you know, they kind of try to push that a little bit to, I mean, make it seem
cool.
More attractive, I guess.
Yeah, it's cool to go to, like, you know, the asylums and the prisons. But Madison was, it was active, very positive vibes there, a lot of residual intelligence. Tom was a nice guy. I told you what we did, and we told him that our one team member fell down the stairs and was pushed by a ghost, and the look on his face was priceless.
Yeah.
But no, I like
hearing all about that story.
Yeah, we actually have a sick sense of humor when you get down to the bone. But yeah, Madison, good place. I always see, you know, on your Facebook, you guys are there. Very good place. I can't say enough good things about it. So I think any group out, and it's very big. So I mean, I think size wise, it works out very well.
Oh, definitely. We held our the first year CPRS was together. We actually held our Halloween event at Madison, and we fit probably about 20 people inside the building, and you know, there really wasn't a problem. So
yeah.
I mean, it's a decent size. I mean, there's two sides to it. You have a basement. You know, it's there are some very good activity there, and you know, that's going to be one of my fail safes every time that I can go there. I'm going to go there. You know, it's just it's never failed to produce results for me, and I know that's egotistical of me to say about a location, because you can always say, you know, a location doesn't always, you know, produce results. You know, that's fine. Yeah, I understand that.
That's what we say at the Calvin Center.
Yeah, you know what? But I've always gone there. I've always, you know, Madison is one of those places that, you know, I take my team up there to train. It's a great place to test out new equipment. is a familiar location. So, and I do believe, you know, especially like you guys with the Calvin Center, the more and more you're inside a location, the more and more the spirits get to know you a little bit better. So maybe possibly you get better evidence.
Yeah, oh, they hate us at the Calvin Center. Every time we lie and say we're not gonna come back, we'll come back with. We had a NBC crew guy down there. We did like a real quick blurb for the Halloween special on WKBN, I think it was the one out of Youngstown. And
yeah.
The cameraman just left. He didn't want it. It was the funniest thing I've ever seen. We did an EVP session with Pandora, and he goes, I've seen enough, and he just leaves. And then it was like the worst news thing I've ever seen. It was like 10 seconds long because there was no footage. And the camera guy just didn't want to be in there because he could just hear, get out! You know, all over, live, you know, and because he didn't really believe it. And the look on his face, he goes, I have what I need. He goes, I'm out of here.
Yeah, that, I mean, when you have something happen to like that, that's probably like probably one of the best experiences you could ever have is that like live intelligent response.
And oh, well, and people, that's what we're all about.
Yeah. You know, and for people that aren't involved in the paranormal and they hear something like that, it really shakes their nerves. It really does.
It does, and it's great to see that. And honestly, Russ, that's what we're all about. That's the thing. Like, we always at the beginning, and not anymore if we should. We had a better, everybody's like, all the ghost events are just running around provoking. I'm like, dude, we haven't provoked anything, I think, since Ballistic, and that was just me showing my, like, youngest, because all I knew was ghost events. We love, you know, the whole stimulating, getting live responses. Like, nothing gets us more excited than getting a live response from a location. And that's why we're so into kind of the dressing up, the reenactment, because we think that brings out a better deal. And even during Paranormal Challenge, you know, people said our EVPs were weak. But we had a good EVP, but they were really good, and we were just obsessed with finding intelligent responses, you know? And, you know, because it's just, I don't know, I think it just, we like that more. You know, you beggars can't be choosers sometimes of locations, but we like it more to be intelligent than anything.
Of course. And, you know, you guys say, you know, you guys kind of got a bad rap because of Paranormal Challenge, you know, and that's neither here nor there. But, you know, you say you guys don't provoke that much. I've been down to Bobby Mackey's before, and mm-hmm. and I remember seeing on your Facebook, and I'm going to be honest with you. I was sitting there going, these guys are freaking crazy. Who was it, Adam, that you had crucified right above Hell's Gate?
We crucified Adam of Hell's Gate while I was reading Revelations from my iPad. That was interesting. Actually, that was probably one of the most horrifying moments because now Wanda Kay, actually, and you want to talk a little about just the paranormal research. God bless her. She's amazing. She
oh, yeah, I've met Wanda before. She's amazing.
You met Wanda.
Yeah.
So she, you know, and she stays with you, and she's watching, and she even says, she's like, I love it because it was so different. And it's funny. Adam goes, you know, how are we going to explain bringing a crucifix into Bobby Mack? I said, listen, Adam, I said, these owners have probably seen everything you can imagine. I'm like, my opinion on life is you just do what you do because nobody's going to tell you it's weird. Nobody wants to make you feel awkward. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So we walk in there. We have to cross that up. I'm reading Revelations. And no shit, Russ. The crucifix, the cross, starts shaking the one side. And I see Adam kind of physically moving his body to try to even it out because I thought maybe it was off base, but it kept going to the one side.
Okay.
And it just freaked me out. He was literally like the cross was moving when we were reading Revelation. And then one EVP we got was when our one guy was down there, and you hear, I believe, and I haven't watched the episode in a while, but it goes either get him or he's coming, referring to somebody else. And you hear Hooven Youve, it's like running across the basement.
Oh, wow.
Towards the devil's toy box that we had out.
Yeah.
I actually, you know, I wouldn't say that's provoking. I'd say I thought that was actually very ingenious to kind of try to trigger something with the exact opposite of what's supposed to be there because, you know, Matthews was active as heck, but we didn't get the evil vibes that, you know, most people get from that place. It was active. It was intelligent. Somebody did throw a camera over with Wanda, you know, watched as that happened. We asked, we said, can you make your presence up? Then one of our cameras, you know, get pushed off the table.
Yeah. See, I've had my experiences down about, and when I was down there, we were in the basement area, and we were down there with a group of probably about 15 people, and we had them split between, you know, the bar area and the basement. And, you know, I've never got a chance to investigate with you or actually sit down and talk with you face-to-face or anything, but I'm real joking, I'm very laid-back, you know, I don't really get serious, because you know how it is, being an investigator as well, you can't be serious all the time, you're going to go crazy.
Oh, God, you go crazy after a few, you go crazy after 2 hours, you got to have a sense of humor.
Exactly. So, you know, I'm always, like, joking around with people, I'm laughing, you know, whatever, and, you know, I know where you have to be serious and where you can joke around. And just out of nowhere, when I was in the basement, I just felt just so angry and aggressive and aggravated. And I swear I felt like I was going to swing on the next person that said something to me. But as soon as I walked out of the basement, I was perfectly fine.
That's funny you say that, because that happened. Adam and I, anybody knows Adam and I. Adam has never once lost his temper. I don't know how the man does it. He's perhaps the most laid-back person I've ever met. I've known him for about 6-7 years. We've been sued by landlords. We've been through the shit. You know, we've been through it. You know, we have a definition of best friends, honestly. Uh-huh. And I lose my temper every now and then, but I've never seen him lose his temper. And it was funny you said that, because when we were filming our intro at Bobby Matthews, we were at each other's throat for some reason. We had no idea why. And we were outside, though. We were outside dinner, but we had no idea why. We just both felt, like, really, really angry, and it was weird.
Yeah, see, I haven't been back there since. That was probably about 2 years ago. You know, but there, I think there is something that is very influential in that basement.
I think there is, yeah.
You know, and what, you know, I know you guys have kind of, you know, that's the first thing I thought. I mean, to be completely honest with you, when you guys came out, you know, I kept hearing about, oh, there's these three guys that are running around and, you know, kind of like yelling at the spirits. And I'm like, oh, so we have another Ghost Adventures. And you guys have kind of been like, from the rumor mill, not exactly the rumor mill, but the word around is you guys are kind of like the YouTube Ghost Adventures, which now that you're sitting down and explaining a little bit more about, you know, because I really haven't seen you guys provoke very much. You guys use trigger objects.
Yeah, we don't. I believe provoking itself is I'm a communication major, I'm running out of my words. It's not conducive to investigating, you know, because
it's not.
Put yourself in the spirit shoes, okay?
Yep.
You see your, what, like, 1,000th customer for the year in your house, and they're yelling at you, why are you going to do anything for them, you know? And especially, like, when you go to places like Pennhurst or Madison, or, you know, these places where, like, you know, these people didn't deserve to be there. It's not like a jail. It's just that back in the day, instead of getting proper life skills support classes or therapy or medication, you know, balance, you know, bipolarism or schizophrenia, they locked them up in a dungeon, basically, and forgot about them. Why the hell are you going to yell at them? What did they do? You know, and why would they want to talk to you if you're going to do that? It's just, I think it's disrespectful. And hey, you're right, when we first came out, everybody said we were YouTube Ghost Adventures, but we did. We basically interrogated the Volusk Axe Murder guy. And,
nope.
You know, it was provoking. I will, you know, and it was, you know, and it was definitely, it was an experience. It was a growing experience for me, because all I had really watched was Ghost Adventures, so I thought that was how you investigated. But I always thought people were adaptable, you know, and I think people saw three guys and they automatically assumed it was Ghost Adventures. And I think one of the biggest shortfalls of, in general, a lot of people we've met is their ability to watch something and learn about it and see that we're not like Ghost Adventures. We don't want to take that route. We almost want to kind of go undercover, you know, in the dead. We love it, and we think that gets the best results most of the time for where we go.
Of course. I mean, I've seen your pictures from, I've watched a couple of your episodes. I've seen pictures, still pictures from your investigations. Pennhurst, you guys were all dressed up in gowns, in mm-hmm. hospital gowns. You know, of course, the Bobby Mackey's one where you had Adam crucified. You know, and, you know, I've even done it myself. Rolling Hills, I got into a wheelchair and wheeled myself down a hall. You know, I'm all about using trigger objects. I know up in Madison, we played up in the ballroom area, the third floor of the one side. We played big band music because during that era, that was used as like a social gathering place. They had dances and things, activities and everything up there. So, I mean, you adapt to your location and you see what you can use. You know, that is really awesome of you guys. And, you know, that's – you guys – I mean, I've seen – I've seen some groups try to go out and try to replicate, you know, the Ghost Adventure style, you know, the three-man team, you go off on your own, you know, whatever. I firmly believe in the you always use the buddy system. Because the simple fact of it is, you may have an experience yourself, but you have no one there to validate it. So if you didn't catch it on video, then it's just a personal experience.
You know, I agree with that. Now, not the buddy system, but the last thing you said is actually the thing that I live and die by. You got to film it, because the day you don't film it, the day something crazy happens and you don't have it on record.
You know as well as I do. You know as well as I do. These spirits, I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off. These spirits know when you are not running equipment. I've had more activity happen before I set up and after I tear down than I've had during an investigation.
Well, and no, you're right. What we did at Prospect, actually, because Prospect was not producing anything for us. Now, I'm not going to say it's not haunted. It's haunted. We all know Prospect is not active. It was just not a good night, I guess.
Yeah.
So we were cleaning up, and I, real quietly, without saying anything, kicked an EVP, an Olympus EVP record. I'm not a big fan of their standard ones, because we use Pandora's all the time now. But kicked one underneath I think, a table up in the third floor ballroom, and we acted like we were leaving. I went up there half an hour later, grabbed it. We had more EVPs in that half hour than we did, you know, when we were trying to get stuff going on. We had Jim up in a pentagram and nothing was happening. So, you know, the buddy system, you know, we kind of stray the opposite just because we feel if you're alone, it's more likely to happen, but you have to have a camera on you. I know for my first paranormal experience, Adam put me alone in Lena Einer's room in Velisca and just let the cameras roll. For Jordan, when she came on, the first thing we did, we chained her to a radiator in Kenhurst and just left her for a half an hour.
And that was her birth by fire. I mean, that was kind of like, that was the first investigation with you guys that she was like actually part of Resident Undead. And, you know, what better place than that? I mean, I know I had one of my team members who I got into this. He had never been to like a big location. And we actually went down. I took him the one weekend actually down to Tala. And the only place he had ever been before was Madison. So you're going from Madison Seminary to Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum.
Yeah, it's like going from the suburbs into the inner city.
Exactly. He just walks in there and he's like, oh, wow, you know. And I remember my first experiences down to Trans-Allegheny. When we were doing the walkthrough, we were on, I think it was the second floor, and we were in one of the med rooms. And our tour guide was like, okay, well, I need somebody to you know, reenact something with me. And I'm like, all right, you know, whatever, that's fine. And there's a cage in the corner of the room. And he put me in the cage, and he was explaining to everyone, he's like, look, you know, when you brought the patients in, you put them in this cage so you can go and mix their medication for them and then give it to them without worrying of them having to, like, attack you or anything like that. And as he's going on with this, he's like, we had a group down here, and out of nowhere, this black mass started forming above this person's head. And I'm standing in this cage, and I'm like, you tell me this after I get in the cage? Thank you. You know, that's awesome. But you know what? I've had a fantastic, fantastic experiences down at Tala. Copperhead, Michelle, all the tour guides down there, they're just amazing, amazing people down there.
Oh, because Copperhead, the White Wizard, man. He's a man. I got to actually hang out with him and Adam Bonnet yesterday. I love him. You know, you want to talk about a genuine person. You've seen it. You've met him. Copperhead is the real deal, man. And
oh, yeah.
I have, you know, endless respect for him and what he does down there. You know, I always tell people, go see Copperhead. You know, he runs West Virginia. Well, he runs West, and Jordan Murphy runs the rest of West Virginia.
So you guys, your team kind of, like, you said you had moved from, you were over by Philly, weren't you?
Yes.
Okay, so you moved over here towards, I believe you're in Edinburgh now?
Yes.
Right around that area. So you moved over here to kind of, like you said earlier, to kind of work more on, you know, RU and everything. Now, does Adam live in Edinburgh as well?
No, Adam's actually down in the Mercer area.
Okay.
So, and then Jordan's in the West Virginia area. So we're pretty much kind of like the boxcar children of the paranormal. I remember I used to, you know, this actually always got me when people at first would, and you know, I'm pretty open to criticism. I know, I guess, from my experience in school and work, it's the only way to get ahead. And we always ask people, what do you like? What don't you like? And our videos actually think changes we've made for the better, because we've got criticism about, you know, I remember Madison taught us a very good lesson about sound and how we needed to get, you know, microphones, Bluetooth microphones or wireless microphones to kill sound method because somebody wrote on our mask, YouTube, the sound sucks during the interview.
Yeah.
So we always look for criticism. You know, we need that to improve. Without criticism, you can't improve. I remember people always just give me flack and like, you know, you guys are just like Ghost Avengers, blah, blah, blah. And every time, I never really said this, but I did make another one point. I was like, listen, I drive 5.5 hours to get to Adam's house. We go another 3 or 4 hours to go on an investigation.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was down near Philly, so, you know, kind of a sidetrack right there. But, so I moved up here. I'm close to Adam. Jordan's in West Virginia, and we try to plan once a month. We go somewhere. Our next trip is actually, we're going down to Trans-Allegheny again in 2 weeks. We're taking a hiatus. We have some projects that come up that we actually have to take a hiatus on. So we're going to be working on some behind-the-scenes stuff. Pretty exciting stuff, you know, knock on wood. And then we actually just confirmed that in June, we're going back to where it all began.
Awesome.
Where it's all going to begin again. We're going back to Villisca, Iowa, June 19th. Their 100th anniversary is actually in June. We're not going to be able to get there on that day. But we're going to get out and get to see our good friend Johnny Hauser.
Awesome, awesome. It's always good to go back to where you started.
Yeah, and it means a lot. You know, Villisca holds a special place in my heart. I love Villisca, Iowa. You know, Darwin, God bless his soul, passed away this past year, the original owner. And he was probably one of the most polarizing figures I've ever met in the paranormal world. I'm not a big believer, but he's very respectful of everybody's opinions, and he's very hands-off. You know, as long as he paid the money to go in, honest man, took you to lunch, gave you a tour, got to see the museum, and he gave us the opportunity to meet Johnny Hauser, who, you know, I think at the crime he's not more publicized, because people always kind of say he's the Villisca tour guy. He's much more than that. He's a filmmaker. He's a producer. Very creative man. Very, he's one of my inspirations out there. I respect the hell out of him. So.
Yeah, Johnny was actually just on one of my friends, Jenny Gurney. He was actually just on her radio show that tonight, actually, from 8 to 10. So I was just on Facebook, and I saw that they were wrapping up their show, and that kind of funny that you had mentioned him. That's one guest I am going to be trying to get on the show here is Johnny, of course. But Dan, what we're going to do is we are going to take a quick little break, probably a 2 or 3 song break, so everyone can run and grab a drink, go to the bathroom, do what they need to do, rest the throats a little bit, and we'll return right after this.
Okay.
Batteries drained. We'll be right back in just a few moments. Take 3 London Lads. Season it with a pinch of humor. Stir in a cup full of debate and discussion. Then sprinkle it with a little controversy. And then add 1 guest.
Hello.
And there's your recipe for UKPN Radio. Join Gary, Darren, and Stuart every Sunday night from 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern, only on the Paramania Radio Network.
He's Bigfoot, he'll eat you with his taters and his greens.
Oh! I am Chris.
I'm Danny.
Megan.
Tanya B.
And we are the Beyond Normal Radio Show.
We ain't normal.
No, absolutely not.
We are, yeah, definitely.
Beyond Normal Radio Show.
Join them for Beyond Normal Radio every Sunday at 7 p.m. Eastern.
Only on the Paramania Radio Network.
Welcome to the all-new Paramania Radio. The views expressed and the opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Paramania, its affiliates, or its sponsors. This show is hosted by Russ Stiver. We now return to Batteries Drained.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to, I guess, would be the second half of the last hour of Batteries Drained. With me still is Dan Hooven. Are you still with us, Dan?
Yes, sir.
Awesome, awesome. Well, while we were on break, I got a question here. Someone else is from PA, somebody that actually lives up in Erie right now. They want to know, what is your favorite local spot in Northwest PA so far, and why?
I haven't really done a lot of places up in Northwest. To be honest with you, I think the closest thing we've done Northwest will be Prospect or Madison. Prospect or Madison is the only places I've really been out here. I actually haven't got a chance to go out to Hillview Manor yet. Obviously, I do like the Calvin Center a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, I guess those two. Sorry, I wish I had a better answer.
So, I mean, you just said that you haven't had a chance to go back out to Hillview yet.
I've never been.
What's that?
I've never been.
You've never been to Hillview?
No. That's when it was just Adam and Jim. I've never been to Hillview, yeah.
Hillview is definitely a good place to go to. I was actually, I don't know what Adam and Jim had caught when they were at Hillview, but I was actually knocked on my ass at Hillview, and it wasn't too fun. Kind of took me by surprise. I was down in the boiler room, and we were actually doing a flashlight session down there. And I said, you know, I was like, you know, I was kind of like knelt down on one knee, and I was like, you know, we're getting awesome hits on the flashlight, but I'm like, I need something more to, you know, prove to me that you're here, that we're talking to someone. And 2 seconds later, I'm laying back on my back. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah, no. I haven't actually had a chance, but Adam says it's a very hot place, and he likes it there. I know it's pretty much one of his first organized ghost hunts that holds a special place in his heart. Uh-huh. I do want to bring up one thing. I just saw it in the chat room. I just want to acknowledge Germany. We see you. We actually have a lot of viewers in Germany on our YouTube, a lot, and man, we'd love to get over there. We'd love to get over there because we get so much support from Germany. Power YouTube, I guess.
That'd be awesome. I mean, I'd love, that's probably something that I'd love to do if I could do it, if I could afford it, is just to go out and travel. Definitely hit Europe, Ireland, Scotland, you know, all those places over there. That'd be awesome to go. So, where is one place for you that you want to go, but you haven't had a chance to go to yet? I'm sure you have a bucket list. Chernobyl,
no doubt. There's a movie out, Hannah. And they took place, there's actually an amusement park that was set open the day after Chernobyl.
Okay.
And it's abandoned. And it was in the movie Hannah. It's very creepy. Just Google Chernobyl amusement park. I'd love to go to Chernobyl. Love to see that place. Absolutely.
See, people kind of look at me a little weird, but you know what? They asked me where I'd like to go. And you know what? I'd love to go over and visit Auschwitz. I'd love to go to one of these concentration camps, because you got to figure, not only as a paranormal investigator, but just as a history.
Yeah.
You still with us?
Okay. Yeah, no, I'm here. That's funny, because that's actually what I was going to say next. It might sound morbid, but we actually want to get out to Auschwitz as well.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm a big history buff. I love the history. I mean, World War II is probably one of my – is like a hot topic for me. And, you know, it sounds morbid, and it sounds – I don't want to say it sounds insensitive, but the history and the energy of those places probably still hold. It's probably off the charts.
Absolutely.
So for you, on your bucket list, the five places that you'd love to go, where – I mean, your top five bucket list on places you want to get to.
Okay. Well, number one, Chernobyl. I love Chernobyl. Number two would be Auschwitz. Number three, I'd like to go to Alaska just for the 30 days a night.
Okay.
I don't have any physical location, but just it's almost like the dead Mardi Gras up there. I guess domestic, I'd want to go down. There's a place in Florida, the Castle of Stones. I forget what the proper name is, but this guy just built a castle out of stones without using equipment. And I'd also like to go to Egypt where the pyramids are and go out there. I think a lot of things go back to Egypt. I'm one of those crazy people. I think a lot of things go back there.
Okay. So, okay. That's cool. Now, on a normal investigation, on a normal setup when you guys do filming, what's your normal setup that you guys use?
It's different. It's really different. Here's the thing, and this is one thing that we're very unabashed about. an investigation, typically you go there, you get everything set up, and you just get into it. For us, it's very different. We usually take about, we usually get there the day before, and we go around and we get filler footage, because for those 30 seconds that you see on our intros, it takes about, you know, a good few days to get that, a good a few hours to get that filler footage. So we go out, we get B-roll, and then, you know, once we're actually set up in the location, we shoot our intros. So it's usually, we usually put about 8 hours into it before we actually get to the investigating. Once we get into it, we just kind of go with the flow. We have our scenes laid out and what we want to do as far as kind of stimulating the dead. We branded it as a ripple in time when we try to do certain things to trigger a response. So, I mean, we kind of free roam, get hit our skits, but we do a lot of free roaming. And so it's a lot of production before. Then you're your standard investigation during. A lot of audio review on spot because you want to be able to mark things down. A lot of history on spot, the interviews. You know, at the end of it, you know, I really fancy ourselves as not only investigators, but documentary makers, you know.
Of course.
One of our big inspirations out there are the Booth Brothers, because I like how, you know, people say you guys are in the paranormal, and they're like, no, we're filmmakers, we just like the paranormal. Respect the hell out of them. And
yeah,
so
actually, I'm going to have next week, next Friday, I'm having Chris Saint Booth on. Yep.
Yeah, that's awesome. And those guys do a lot out there, and we've been able to, you know, make, you know, casual contact with them. But for a lot of us, we do a lot of pre-production. And it's just, you know, it does, you know, kind of go into our thing where we film to make a product, so it's not going to be like, all these teams want to, you know, investigate, work with us, whatever. They probably kill us because they don't want to do the 8 hours of pre-production. You know, they might not think that's fun. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying that's what we do. So it's different than a lot of other groups where we can't just investigate.
Exactly. I mean, that's the big thing about TV, especially when you guys were on Paranormal Challenge as well. You know, it's one of those things where a lot of people don't realize how much goes into an actual production of this. I mean,
oh, no, good.
People think that, oh, yeah, that hour show, they were only there for, you know, a day or two doing that. No, ghost hunters, ghost adventurers, things like that, you're there for anywhere from 7 to 10 days. You know, not everything that they show is from one night.
We literally have 18 external terabyte hard drives filled with footage.
Oh, wow.
And you know, we film. I mean, you get done with it, we have about 20 hours of footage. I mean, you have three cameras, one, you know, two stationaries, other things, you know. We probably, for every hour episode, I'd say we have about 20 to 30 hours of footage. And just between the three cameras and everything and production-wise. And, you know, this comment, and I think this is taken out of context, and it really kind of irked me a little bit personally, is that there was another group that asked us, you know, well, we want to make episodes. It seems everybody's making episodes on YouTube now. I mean, because when we got into it, the only episodes we saw were ghost guys or whatever, and they were kind of not active for a little bit.
Yeah.
Which is cool, you know, seeing people kind of want to do the YouTube and I use it. You know, I'm not saying I think we kind of got the wheel rolling again because they saw what we were doing. But they asked them, we gave them some advice, and I said this, and this is, I think, taken out of context, but I think it really needed to be said. I said, listen, I said, there's a big difference between investigating and posting footage and creating, you know, a product. I said, you can't just hit record and hope an episode magically appeared, because, you know, each of these episodes, Adam's putting in 30 or 40 hours of editing in these, because you have to line up the audio, you have to write a storyboard, you have to flow, you have to make sure it makes sense, angles, verify information. So I would say our product's a lot more high maintenance. It's a lot more high maintenance than just posting evidence. There's nothing wrong with just posting evidence, because that's what a lot of people do. We just choose to take a documentary route with it.
Of course. Of course. I think that helps out a little bit more. I mean, it's not like you guys are trying to do a show or anything, but you guys are pretty much giving a full story, a full background on the location. You know, you guys are showing everyone that, okay, this is it. You know, this is, you know, you do the walk-arounds, you do the interviews and things like that, and then you jump right into the investigation of it. I mean, I think the way you guys set up your episodes is very, it flows very well. It's the segues into each portion of it are very well done. You and Adam, I know Adam does a lot of the editing, but he does an awesome job.
Yeah, he does all of it. And go ahead.
No, go ahead. No, I was just laughing about that.
Adam does an awesome job, and it's ironic because I actually went to school for video production and communications. I got more into theory and personal behavior, and he actually has a degree in political science. And you know, he just did this all on his own. And I think that he stayed silent about it, and he never touts it. But this man literally taught himself how to make these episodes from ground up. And if you ever saw if people ever saw what it looked like behind the scenes as far as building it, it's amazing. And you know, we're proud of the product. I'll be honest with you. I mean, I always try to put myself in the third person view. I think what we produce, and I've said this, I'm not bashful of things. I think what we produce is on par, if not better, than some of the shows that are on television right now. I think it's more engaging. I think we don't insult the audience. What we try to avoid is jumping to conclusions, saying, did you hear that? Could that be the spirit of John Doe trying to communicate with us? You know, we try to give you the evidence, and it's hard for us because, you know, to the casual viewer, you have to just almost blast them because we're all in the YouTube generation where you need every 7 seconds something different happening. And it's hard to balance because we try to cater to the casual fan of the paranormal, but, you know, at the same time, I hate explaining things over and over about how devices work because most people that watch this are very passionate about it because they know how the spirit box works.
Of course.
It's hard, you know. It's so much work goes into it that I don't think Adam gets enough credit for it personally, but he doesn't want that. He just loves creating a product. So it's a whole new ballgame when you go into creating episodes, and I don't, you know, like I said, it's just what we do. It's what we like to do, and it's worked out well, but I really do believe it's better than some of the stuff I see on TV, and this might be my own arrogance coming through, but from a perspective where I watch it, you know, I love it. I think there are things that can be changed. We always talk about changing things, kind of shortening the bursts, making it a little bit shorter. But I love it. I think they're just entertaining as all heck. I think we have a good chemistry, you know?
They are. I mean, you guys really do play well. I haven't watched a Penhurst episode yet.
Oh, that's not up yet. But it's
well, the preview of it. Yeah, I mean, I haven't watched anything of that yet, but how is it working with Jordan? I mean, you guys were used to having a three-man team, and now you have you, Adam, and Jordan. How was Jordan's first investigation at Penhurst?
Well, she actually joined us as a guest investigator in Tennessee in September, and we really hit it off. You know, Jordan is a valuable asset in the community, and here's why. You know, one of the things, and I feel for her because it frustrates her a lot, is that, you know, she's very talented. Her backstory, she's been in paranormal for years, very knowledgeable. She's very well-spoken. She'll talk to you about alternate dimension theory, parallel universes for hours, you know. Unbelievably intelligent. And one of her things that she really wants and she liked about us is that, you know, when we talked to her, we never once brought up how she looked or made a pass at her. We were interested in what she had to say, how she could add to the product. And I know one of her goals is to really kind of progress the female in the paranormal community. She felt our product was a good stepping stone, a good platform for that, because even though people may not like myself or Adam, myself more in particular, they can't deny our product. We're good at what we do. You know, we make good films. And Jordan, I think, I feel for her because, you know, honestly, you know, I'm over the frat boy day. I don't find girls running around in bikinis and showing their midriff and, you know, showing their cleavage sexy. Mm-hmm. I think sexy is something like Jordan, where you have somebody who's confident, who's a good role model. I see these groups out there, and I've personally addressed this before, where I think it hurts the whole paranormal legitimacy, where they're running around giving makeup tutorials and Jordan explaining how to use a spirit box, you know? And I think one of her goals is to really establish a strong, positive female role model for young girls and be able to expand the field, because there's a lot of talented females out there, I mean, that don't get exposure because you have girls that I think are detracting from the female investigator.
You know, they aren't just a pretty face. They actually have something of substance to say and to add to this field.
And it bothers me because I see people saying, oh, you guys are the best paranormal investigators. But all they've done in the past year is take pictures of themselves in bikinis. They haven't even investigated once. And I think that's sad. And I think Jordan is the exact opposite. I think she's a very beautiful lady, but she's competent. She's, you know, she's an amazing addition. She's going to really help us. I think aesthetically, you look at us three and we feed off each other well. We're very unique individuals, and I'm really excited to work with her, and she's passionate, man. She's hardcore. She's passionate.
She's ready to go. She's ready to up in the morning and ready to go.
Absolutely, man. It's a pleasure to have her. We're blessed to have met her, you know.
That's awesome. That is awesome. Now, I had a question in here that actually somebody just sent me on Skype. What valuable lessons or tips regarding the field did you learn about from your experience on Paranormal Challenge that you think is important to share with others?
Don't trust producer when they say you look good. you know, I learned right there that, here's the thing, man, you know, I learned that you really need to stay true to yourself as far as when you're investigating, because a lot of things that really pissed me off were that we got shortchanged. I understand what they were doing. It's entertainment versus reality, two different things. When Adam said, we don't like girls either, they showed the whole scenario. We were actually doing the role-playing. We were telling Roy how we don't have girlfriends and how girls hated us and how we understand what it's like to be a misfit and we don't like girls either. Of course, yeah. They just got to, we don't, you know. Stay true to yourself. Do what you do. Do what you're comfortable with. We did a lot of role-playing. We were speaking German in Nurse Emma's room. At one point, and it was a spectacle. I'm glad it didn't show, but I was on Adam's shoulder trying to communicate with Roy because he was like 7 foot tall.
Yeah, I've Roy before. I've been up to Rolling Hills. I actually just had Sharon on my show about 3 weeks ago. And, you know, Sharon and I still talk all the time and everything. And I've had my run-ins with Roy before, so.
Yeah, and I think just stay true to yourself, honestly. Find the style that you feel comfortable with and just keep an open mind. Like, there's certain things I don't believe in, certain things I may not support, but I always keep an open book because I think in the unknown, you can't say something's not right or wrong. It's more of a comfortability thing. Yeah, just keep an open mind. That's what I always tell people, keep an open mind. Nobody's ever going to be right. Nobody's ever going to be wrong. And we both know that the only time we're going to know what's really going on is when we're on that other side.
Exactly, exactly. You know what? And that's funny because there was, and I'm pretty sure you know the application that I was talking about. I'm not really going to say anything on air about it, but the application I just filled out recently, it had a question on there, and the application had said, you know, how would you rate yourself as an investigator? Are you a beginner, a novice, intermediate, advanced, or expert? And I just kind of had to chuckle about it a little bit because I'm like, they really had to throw an expert on there. And I mean, I don't know your stance on it, but I firmly believe there are no experts in this field whatsoever.
Hey, I'm with you 100%. I've seen those applications before. When we did Paranormal Challenge, they have the same thing. I wrote on it. I might have been just ignorant, but there's no such thing as an expert. Anybody who says they are doesn't know anything. And that was my answer.
Hey, well, you know what? At least you were honest about it. You were honest about it, and that's what you have to be. You know, people ask me, you know, you've been doing it for so long. You know, I've been doing this for 14 years. My first ever investigation was actually at Mansfield Reformatory and when I was 14 years old. And they're like, you know, you've been doing this so long. When I started doing this, I was using recorders that ran the little cassette tapes. So, I mean, we didn't have digital recorders back then. We were using 35-millimeter cameras. And dowsing rods and compass were, you know, your normal equipment sack. I mean, now you have things that take more batteries that could probably run a car. So it's funny. And they're like, well, you know, you must be an expert in this by as many years as you've been in it. I'm like, no, I'm really not. I would consider myself a more advanced than some people, but not nearly as much of an expert as at anything. I love doing audio. I know I can jump into an audio program and pick apart an EVP and, you know, splice it up and everything. You know, that's what I love working on is audio. And, you know, but like, I'll have people say, well, you must be an expert on it. No, I'm not. And I actually get offended when people say, well, you're an expert. No, I'm really not. It's there are no experts. Everyone's always going to be, you know, the field is constantly changing. Everything's coming. Something new is coming out every day.
I think the word that I think really is appropriate in any situation is a resource. I think everybody's a different resource. I think, you know, if I had audio, I'd reach out to a resource like yourself. And I think, you know, we get it. You know, we get it. There's no such thing as an expert, but there is such thing as resources and
yes.
people that you can talk to. And that's what networking is about. And I don't keep a very large network. I keep most of it in-house. But, I mean, you know, I know who to talk to if I need to go over something. And they're not going to, you know, make me feel stupid for asking them. They're going to help me understand why. Because I'm very visible when it comes to my shortcomings. You know, I just am. You know, I put it out there. I say, hey, I'm not good at this. Can you help me so I can learn? I think, you know, but then again, I think that's a sign of an intelligent person, you know, honestly.
Well, that's also very respectable on your part because you're not going to try to BS your way through it. You're going to just be like, hey, I don't know how to do this. I don't understand this. Can you help me? You know, that's a lot more respectable and a lot more admirable than just going, oh, well, you know, stumbling through something and instead of asking for the help. So that makes you more of a respectable and more reliable source than anything would. And I always tell people, you know, you can ask me anything you want to. If I don't know the answer, I will get it for you.
Yeah, I always point at people. Everybody, when I felt bad, people would ask me, I'm like, well, ask Adam, you know, ask this person. I point them in different directions. You know, I'm not one. I'm good at certain things. I'm not good at other things. What makes everybody, you know, useful in the grand scheme of things.
Well, you know, everybody on a team, and I know you probably experienced this as well, but everybody on a team has their own things that they're good at, you know, and you rely on those other people to really play off of you.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I mean, that's one of the greatest things about it is having those people that you can rely on that are able to help you. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, it's one of those great things. But, you know, what's next for Resident Undead? I mean, what do you? I know you were talking a little bit before the break about how you guys are kind of taking a little hiatus on a couple projects because you're working on something now. Where do you guys see yourself in another year from now?
Oh, man. you know, hopefully somewhere pushing the product because I really do believe that what we have, and this is coming from pure, you know, marketing sense, you know, and that's what I do, you know. I'm trained in, so I'm educated in. I feel our product has a lot of appeal, you know. I can see us, you know, maybe doing some work with documentaries, releasing them through a production company. You know, it's hard when you want to succeed as a group because, I mean, I saw all these things recently with the whole reality casting thing. I think I got spammed by 25 people. Thank you for not spamming me if anything else. I appreciate that. But I got spammed by like all, and half of them I don't even know, right? And it's hard to see because it seems like everybody, you know, not everybody in the field, but the entertainment aspect of it, they have the two franchises, Ghost Hunters, Ghost Adventures. I'm not a big fan of the Ghost Hunters franchise. You know, I just don't find it appealing, but I understand their place. And you know, so I don't know. I don't know where Resident Evil is going to be in the year. Hopefully somewhere successful where we can get our product to more people. I love to work with a production company in Germany. We have a fan base out there, and we love interacting with them. And I just feel like we really bring something new to the table. You know, we really do. We stick out.
You have those personalities.
More so Adam. I think Adam has a very good presence. Jordan has a very unique personality. I kind of, you know, I always say I'm just the third guy. You know, I'm okay with that role.
Yeah.
And I just think that, you know, for Adam, I like to see his hard work pay off. He doesn't care about the money. He'll tell you, he just doesn't, you know, his favorite line from Batman is that money burns, you know. He doesn't care about that. He wants, but these videos are his legacy. I mean, so I'd like to see something break for him. And whether it involves myself and Jordan, great. If it doesn't, you know, better for him. But a year from now, man, I don't know. I really don't know.
That's a long road ahead.
Yeah.
Okay, now getting into equipment-wise, when you guys go to set up on an investigation, what's your normal setup that you guys use? I mean, do you guys run a 4-system DVR? Do you run an 8-system? Do you guys just use strictly handheld?
We actually use strictly handheld. We don't have a DVR system just because with production time and review would be impossible, honestly. And if, you know, the way we shoot our episodes are, we really kind of want to act as a tour guide for the actual viewers. So we want to have us on camera. as well, or Adam to explain the situation. I know a lot of people get flack. It's kind of like if you're looking for ghosts, why is the camera always on somebody else? It's just kind of bring you in and immerse you. So equipment-wise, you know, we have our handheld, very nice cameras, high-end. Thank you. Thank you, Discover, for the nice credit limit that you bogged me down with. And, you know, we just basically attach everything we can to our bodies and just go for it. You know, our favorite piece of equipment, we love the Pandora's Box. That's the name we've given it, best voice recording in the world. I'm a big fan. I actually have that Fuji Fine Pix Full Spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
That was actually came out for Paranormal Challenge. Amazing piece of equipment. Just the cameras, Pandora, the Full Spectrum. Obviously, we have a Spirit Box, Melmeter, Standard Fare. We do run another, you know, those standard voice recorders. They don't really catch much anymore. It's kind of disappointing because we have the other ones. And we do, you know, we always have duct tape because you never know where Adam's going to want to duct tape me in any situation.
Of course, you know, people joke with me, and, you know, I normally walk around with a backpack on, and it keeps...
Too. It's what you need to do.
Exactly. You know, it's one of those things where, you know, it's better to have it and not need it and need it and not have it. So when I start an investigation, I throw everything I could possibly use into the backpack so I don't have to keep going back and forth, you know, grabbing new pieces of equipment. And off to one side of my backpack, I have a roll of electrical tape hanging off my backpack. And everyone always laughs at me, and they're like, why do you need electrical tape? And I'm like, you just never know when you're going to need it. And
yeah.
I've run into things before where I've needed some electrical tape, and I've laughed at people. I'm like, see, you didn't think I'd need it.
Yeah. No, I actually joke that part of my character is I always have a book bag on. Because I just, you know, I always carry my book bag because it's better to have it than not have it, you know. It's just, you know, I'd rather have a million batteries on me than none, because, you know, when you don't have a battery, something's going to happen, something's going to die.
Yep, that's how it's always going to happen. Now, what for you, what is your favorite piece of equipment?
I love the Full Spectrum. I love it. You know, we don't get a lot of results with it. We've gotten some interesting things at Bobby Matthews with it. I love the Full Spectrum. And I also absolutely love Pandora. It's the best voice recorder out there. And, you know, so those two pieces of equipment, they're really what we push in our episodes because they get, well, actually just the voice recorders, because that gets very, that gets, in my opinion, the best evidence out there. If only I could afford a flare gun, I'd have one of those. I actually broke one of those on Paranormal Child. I stepped on one, and, you know, $10,000 went out under my foot.
Oh.
I was left about that.
How was the production company about that one?
I don't think they care. They didn't say anything. I mean, the one kid from Moundsville dropped one of their $25,000 cameras, so they had bigger fish to fry. But the Pandora's Box is just an amazing, you know, I mean, hell, it's horrifying. It scares me all the time. We just had one where we had a recording here, clear as day, take down Adam. Because, you know, I think sometimes the spirits think that he is like the alpha, you know, he's in charge of everything. If they take him out, they can get to us, you know. And so we get a lot of innocent things through there, like who's there, what's your name. But for the entertainment purposes, of course, we just share the crazy stuff.
Of course. You know, that's, you know, you guys, the way you guys have your episodes set up and everything, it's a lot of first-person camera work. Now, I have to ask you, what do you think, in your opinion, since you've been with Adam from the start of this, what was probably one of the craziest moments that ever happened to you?
One of the craziest, two of them actually, both of them were at Saddamsville.
Okay.
And I love that place. It's heartbreaking to hear what's happening. That place is, love it. I love it. The owner is amazing. We were filming, and we have wireless Bluetooth mics, and Adam and I jumped at the same time because I could hear on his mic something running at him, full charge, and we jumped same time because I could hear it through his mic and he could hear it right behind him, and that freaked me out because it came through the mic and you're just not expecting that, I guess, to both simultaneously jump when you hear something running by. Kind of validates it a lot more. And I also got scratched. It was the only place I've ever got scratched, and I got scratched in real time, and that was very you know, I didn't like it, you know. It scared the hell out of me because we were in a place that was supposedly a shelter for priests, and I'm getting scratched. It was two scratches, which is weird. It wasn't the Trinity or whatever. It was two scratches that went all the way down my back. So those two moments really, they got to me. They really did get to me. And Adam did tell me in Villisca, when we got back to the hotel room, he kept hearing somebody just telling him to do it. Because when we go to sleep, he takes up an extra 2 hours uploading everything. Mm-hmm. And he said he just kept hearing a voice telling him to do it. Do it. Like, almost like it was a comment that hurt one of us.
Wow. That's you know, definitely, I mean, you definitely can take something home from an investigation. So that's for sure. So,
oh, yeah.
But anyways, what we're going to do right now is we're going to take another short little break. It's about 10:27 right now, so we'll come back here in a little bit, and we'll finish out this interview. Got a couple more questions for you. So everyone stay tuned, and we'll be right back.
Batteries drained. We'll be right back in just a few moments. Do you want to hear what real paranormal investigators are up to? Well, get down in the trenches with Chris Deadman as I interview real paranormal investigators on Dead Time. Sundays, 9 p.m. Eastern, only on the Paramania Radio Network.
He wasn't giving me the information I needed, evasive, and finally I felt that he was playing games.
Dead Time.
Setting aside.
Journey through the world of parapsychology by exploring the human mind, the spiritual realm, and all the unlocked doors of the universe. The Skeleton Key. Hosted by Paranormal Sarah. Every Monday at 10 p.m. Eastern. Only here on the Paramania Radio Network.
Watching her strolling.
For more information, visit www.paranormalsarah.org. If you have a comment or question, then please call in now. In the U.S., call 919-295-0150. UK listeners can call 076-240-8277. You can also call in using Skype to Paramania Radio or Google Talk to ParamaniaRadio@gmail.com. And lastly, you can use the phone icon above the chat box to call directly from your computer.
You are listening to Paramania Radio. You are listening to Paramania Radio. Call in now.
This show is hosted by Russ Stiver. We now return to Adderies Drained.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the last part of Batteries Drained. With us still is Dan Hooven of Resident Undead. Before we left, you were talking about actually getting scratched and everything when you guys were down at the rectory down there. And, you know, I've kind of had my personal experience with that as well. You know, actually, that came from Madison. And, you know, I'm not a big believer in scratches because I believe that, you know, you could, like, subconsciously not even realize it, just, you know, scratch your neck or whatever like that. But I had on 4 shirts. I had on a tank top. I had on a t-shirt. You know, I had on another, like, polo shirt on top of that and a sports jacket. And sure enough, right across the left-hand side of my rib cage on my back, I had one set, and then shortly after that, I had another set. And it was one of those things. I didn't feel, you know, I didn't feel threatened. That was the weird thing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, so I had asked you before, you know, what were your crazy experiences? You know, you guys are known for doing a lot of role playing, a lot of trigger play or trigger objects, things like that. Besides for the crucifixion of Adam down at Bobby Mackey's, what do you think would be the big moment that, you know, you thought was the craziest thing that you guys ever done to try to get a response?
Now, the crucifixion was pretty crazy. We actually did a mock lynching at Prospect Place where I was hanging in the barn from the noose.
Mm-hmm.
I almost got hung because when they cut me down from it, Adam did cut the relief rope by accident, and if Jim wasn't there to hold me, I would have literally been, like, lynched right there. They would have had to hold me up and cut me down.
Oh, wow.
That was pretty crazy. And, Old Tough Pittsburgh Hospital, we actually just duct taped me in a wheelchair in the poltergeist room, and I was, like, real tired. I remember saying, we have the EVP online. I remember saying, man, I feel tired, but, man, it's cold. I feel real cold in here. And an EVP right behind me after we did the review goes, hey, kid, it's me. And I'm there duct taped in a wheelchair. Pennhurst, we actually, and we had to walk a really, really respectful line because Pennhurst, you know, these kids were abused. That's what it was. It was honestly, you know, abuse. And
yeah,
it was horrible. And we wanted to walk a thin line because we wanted to show our respect to the place. So one thing, we actually had a situation where Jordan was a nurse, and they actually put me in one of the actual cribs from Pennhurst in a gown. And I remember, and it was heartbreaking because, you know, and Jordan was like, you know, I want to help you, but if you can't help me, acting like she was a nurse that really wanted to help, I was overwhelmed because it was like 30 patients in one person.
Yeah.
And the funding, you know, an interesting fact, you know, the Philadelphia Zoo, Pennsylvania allocated more money per zoo animal than per person at Pennhurst.
Oh, wow.
Back in the day. And I remember when, you know, Jordan was saying, you know, you need to tell me what you want to do or I can't help you. I heard a little girl say right near the doorway, somebody help him. And that was really, that was a big moment. So Pennhurst was just, it's very emotional. You know, it's very emotionally dense there.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. I would have to say. And I have to ask, I've seen the still pictures from Pennhurst. What's with the chains?
You know, here's the thing. And we actually talked about this. We always try to keep everything relevant. Now, the chains, originally what we were going to do is we were going to try to get into the tunnels, and that's why we had the gas mask, and it was more of a shock and awe effect. We were going to chain Jordan up in the tunnels and leave her. We weren't able to get into the tunnels. It just wasn't, weather permitting, wasn't possible. They're not open right now for reasons.
Uh-huh.
So we came to this thing where, it was a debate, but I said, this really doesn't make any sense when it goes to the history. But at the same time, you know, it's kind of shock and awe. So what we did was, you know, Pennhurst has gone through a lot of renovations. They've probably seen people in there with gas masks and asbestos. So we acted as if we were, you know, working on a building, changing the environment, if you would. You know, and that sometimes can trigger activity. And we chained Jordan up to a radiator and just acted as if she was, you know, one of the first outsiders to go there.
Uh-huh.
So it was shock and awe. A little bit different. We wanted to kind of create that sense of helplessness. And, you know, there were rumors back in the day in those places where there were people chained up as forms of just behavioral therapy in those days were chaining people up. So it was kind of shock and awe versus what may have happened there. A little bit of triggering through tending to be people changing the environment. It was a cool visual. It was definitely neat. Actually, funny thing that's going to be on there. Pennhurst is real known for, it used to get broke into a lot, right?
And kind of so the same way that Waverly was.
Yeah, I went to high school down there, so it was a homecoming for me, but half my high school used to break in there. I never went there personally, but a lot of people I know, or not know, but a lot of people in my high school went there. And so the cops are out there. So we actually had a standoff with the state cops, and I had 20 feet of chain wrap on my fist because they were trying to get in, but I didn't believe that they were cops. So we actually have it on raw video of a standoff between us and the state cops. And the owners of Pennhurst actually call me the paranormal ghost rider because I was there chaining on my fist, refusing to open the door. we were actually literally locked in because the cops couldn't even get into the place.
Oh, wow. That's crazy. I would have to say that's probably, wow, that you don't hear too often that you have a standoff with the cops and the cops want in and you won't let them in.
Yeah. Well, I didn't know who they were. I didn't see, they wouldn't give it a bad number. I'm very paranoid, you know. So.
Of course, because, you know, you're out there alone. I mean, there's just three of you. So,
yeah.
What could happen? I mean, really. So, I mean, that's the risk you take.
yeah, we had our number to call if there was anything that happened, and it was more funny after, but you really saw a personality shine through, I think, in that raw moment.
Yeah, definitely. That'd be definitely something that I'd like to see the raw video of that. That would be quite funny to see, actually. now, what would you say your favorite place that you've investigated has been?
I'm gonna just actually say Pennhurst. Pennhurst and Villisca. Villisca holds a special place, but Pennhurst was, good God, man, that place is just active.
Really?
Maybe because it's been so preserved for so long. But Pennhurst. Pennhurst.
That Pennhurst was an awesome, I'd love to get up there. I would absolutely love to get up there. I've looked into it several times before, and now that you guys have posted, now that they're actually opening up now for tours, I definitely love to get in there and take my time with it. So,
yeah, it's worth it. It's definitely worth it.
Definitely. And, as you know, as well as, I do and everyone else, when you do this as a hobby, a lot of money comes out of your pocket, for travel, for, equipment, for everything, and it's hard to get to a lot of the places you want to get to. So.
Yeah, it's a challenge. It's one of those things, you've got to you do it because you do it. It's not going to make you rich, but it's going to be one hell of a story.
Definitely. And it's all about the experiences you leave behind. It's not about what money you spend. It's not about, whatever. It's where you've been. I firmly believe in that. And, I noticed Adam's post earlier when he was saying that, Pennhurst is now open and everything. That's one thing I actually really pride myself on is actually making these relationships with these location owners. I was up at Rolling Hills probably 3 years ago now, and I still talk to Sharon probably on a weekly basis. I talked to Candy from Hillview. I think the only person I really don't stay in touch with anymore is Tina Mattingly from Waverly. And that's really because she's so busy that, it is really hard to get a hold of her. So, go ahead.
I don't know. I was going to say, you bring up a good point, and I think that the owners are the silent heroes in all this, because if these people weren't willing to spend the money and put in time, we wouldn't have these locations. And, we talked about this before. A lot of people don't like us, and that really slides off my back. And it's not that I really don't care. My concern is the relationships with the owners. And it's funny, for every person that thinks we're just the worst people in the world, the people that actually meet us and trust us with their property, we have good relationships. I'm proud to say, I call Juan Decay a friend, I call Johnny Hauser a friend, I call, Tim and Phil from Pennhurst a friend. It's about building those relationships, and really, they are the silent heroes. Without them, we'd be screwed,
Oh, definitely. And you know what? Bringing up Madison again, Tom has done such a fantastic job up there with that place, keeping it up and running. I mean, it really is a historical location. It's definitely one of the hidden gems, one of the locations off the beaten path, I guess you could say. And I know personally, I've gone up there a couple times and cleaned a little bit and helped out. I've actually cleaned that place top to bottom, swept all the floors, did some landscape work for him and everything. And I know he really appreciates that. So anytime you can actually help out a location owner or whoever runs the location, it's what you do. Not for the hidden agenda, but it's what you do for that location that actually really shows, what type of person you are. And that's one thing I hold true to myself is the character of myself. I'm huge. I love talking to people. I love building those relationships, and it's keeping those relationships. And you were saying about how, there's not a lot of people out there that like you guys and everything like that. Honestly, you guys may have gotten a little flack for being on Paranormal Challenge and how the production company portrayed you. Not exactly how you guys were, but how the production company wanted you to be. And, I think that's where a lot of that stems from. But you know what? You guys have a good product you guys are doing. You guys have solid evidence that you guys are catching. And I say just, I'm the same way. Don't worry about what people are thinking about you. Just do what you do. You know what you do best, and no one's going to tell you differently.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's all you can do. when a lot of things happen, I say, you know, what we're going to do is we just keep our heads and up and we keep moving, because, you know, other people out there don't define us. We're going to define what we do with our product. And say what you want about my character, but our evidence, you know, nobody can ever, ever go after that because it's just solid. But yeah, these owners, man, I mean, they're good people. It's great what they provide to us. And you know, one thing that we do is that, you know, we make these videos, but we also, you know, we tell the owners, hey, use it for whatever you want. It's on YouTube. If you want to, you know, use it to promote your property, do it. If you want, you know what I mean? Like, we're very open with that. We try to say that, give that as our thank you card. You know, use the video if you want it. It's there. Take it. You know, we don't make any bones about it. And it's what we can offer, I guess. And, you know, I remember we got really just bombarded a little bit ago. And, you know, we said one thing about it. We said, you know what? We don't care anybody says this. You know, we said, we don't go looking for trouble. It finds us. We go to our locations. We pay our fees. We leave. We clean up and leave in a respectful manner. Owners like us. Leave us alone. Like, and I think, you know, I don't think it's all for paranormal challenge. I think people have gotten over that. I think, you know, there's a lot of insecurity out there. I don't know why people would be insecure enough to attack us. It's just that we're able to produce a product, and you know, we're into the film and production aspect more so than most groups. And people come after that like it's something bad. And I'm like, not really. I think it's a good thing. I think it gets the casual people involved in it, you know. Because usually in the paranormal, if you have a personal experience, if you start out casually watching ghost adventures or ghost hunters and want to get into it, I think it's a progressive thing that we're doing, trying to get more people involved.
Oh, definitely. You know, and I agree completely with you on that. You know, and that's why we caught flack last Halloween, because we did our Halloween event at Hillview Manor. And, you know, we sold 40 tickets to the public. We actually sold our event out. And it was awesome, because with the 40 tickets we sold, as well as our team members that are there, we brought in probably about 52 people into Hillview Manor to do an investigation. And, you know, we caught flack from a couple people because of, they're like, oh, well, you're doing this, you know, for the money and everything like that. I'm like, you know what? Honestly, we're not. We actually upcharged $5 a ticket for our Halloween event, because the simple fact that it is, we actually supplied pizza yeah, and drinks and snacks and everything like that for everyone. And if we hadn't have done that, that would have come out of our pocket. And they yeah, have to remember, we're already paying our fee to get in to investigate. Plus, if we were to have to buy food, so that's just coming out of our pocket. And the reason we do a Halloween event every year is to kind of get those casual people out there, the people that, you know, can't get into these locations otherwise, or, yeah, you know, just kind of want to go and check out and see how it is. And, you know, it really did open up. I mean, I didn't lead a group. I was more or less a floater. I was jumping around from group to group from night to night. And the more times that I peeked in on a group, a lot of the people were just sitting there and just so intently staring at, you know, what was going on and listening to, you know, the team members of CPRS explaining what each piece of equipment does, because these people watch it on TV, but they don't see what goes in behind an actual investigation. They see that 45 minutes of, oh, there was a sound, here's the evidence, here was this, 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 and this. And it's kind of funny, because somebody on the event actually that came to the event, I heard them over talking, and they were like, well, I thought this was supposed to be fun. And I just had to laugh about it. I'm like, do you realize how many locations that I've walked into, and I have sat there for 8 hours, and I have not – I could hear a pin drop. But when you go home and review what you have, that's when everything comes out.
Yeah, and actually, it's funny. One of the people in my graduate classes went to that event. I forget the name, but they were talking about it, because I heard them over talking about Hillview. They didn't seem to really like me, but, you know, I think they watched the show. But they said they were going to Hillview for an event with you guys. I made them connect the dots through Facebook and everything.
well, I hope they enjoyed it, at least.
Oh, they did. No, they said they had a really good time. They said they captured some evidence. And she was a first-timer, and she, you know, like you said, she said it was nice to go with the group, and she said everybody was real friendly. So I remember her talking. I forget her name, but she definitely, it was about Halloween. I made the connection, because she said she was going to Hillview with this event, and I saw it on Facebook you guys were doing it. So, small world, man.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, but with us being so close together, it's awesome, you know.
Yeah, Yeah, yeah. And
we have still yet to get together to do, I mean, either a joint investigation or just to sit down. I mean, you know, you're only a hop, skip, and a jump away from me. I mean, that's for sure. And if you guys are ever over in Youngstown or whatever, like I said, I'm right down the street from the Calvin Center.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, we do have to make our way over there soon. So, I mean, we'll figure something out. It really is a small world. We have been able to meet up with some groups, you know. It's just kind of, we're always running around. This is the first weekend I've been home in 3 weeks. So it gets tough. I mean, we're on the road a lot. We're always trying to do something. It's hard, but it's
oh, awesome definitely.
At the same time. So, yeah, I really have given up so much for this. But I think everybody has, you know.
You know what? Everyone gives up just a little bit to do it. But you know what? That's the sacrifices you make. I mean, I hate to say it that way, but, you know, it is one of those things that, you know, if you really want to dive into this, not saying the right way, but if you really want to dive into this and put your whole, you know, your heart and soul into something that you have a truly passion for, then, you know, you are going to sacrifice some things.
Well, I think the best way to put it, and I agree with you 100%, is you're going to get out of it what you put into it.
Exactly.
And, you know, it's like I said, it's extremely rewarding. But I love every second of it. I just wish, you know, some things were different about it. Like, I've never really seen a community that was very, you know, I think we catch a lot of flack because I believe in paranormal. Everybody talks about paranormal unity. I just say paratolerance. I'm like, just let everybody be and do what they do. We do get a lot of flack for that because we're not gung-ho about that. Just, I guess, from our experiences, we always just kind of, you know, we have our friends out there, and we just leave it at that, basically. So we do get a lot of flack for that. But it's definitely unique. I've never experienced anything like it before in my life.
You know, 9 times out of 10, a lot of the people that you're catching flack from or that are getting ignorant with you or, you know, whatever it may be, 9 times out of 10, it's just jealousy. And I've learned that, you know, it may be because, you know, you're able to go to a location. I've had people get ignorant with me because of Madison. And, you know, I've actually had to defend Madison before because I've had someone go, well, I went there and I did an investigation for 5 hours and we didn't get anything. They're full of crap. That place isn't haunted. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, I could sit down. I have folder upon folder on my computer of EVPs, of pictures, of things that I have caught there that I could pretty much put you to shame on. Yeah. And, you know, people, you know, I like I said earlier, I firmly believe the more and more you go to an area, the more and more the spirits become familiar with you. And, you know, I think with Madison is that we were just back up there on Saturday. And I walked in through the back door of the area, and I hit the hallway where the basement is, right there, that little causeway area. And I hear a female voice go, "Hey, Russ." And I'm like, and I had no females around me. Well, I had one behind me, but she wasn't talking at all because she was just kind of sitting there and looking at her recorder. And just out of nowhere, I just hear, and I'm like, I turn around. I'm like, did you just say, I'm like, I've been with you in the car the entire time. Did you just say my name? And she's like, no, I didn't say anything. So, I mean, it's those little things that you get, you know, it's awesome.
Yeah.
You know? So, but we have about 4 minutes left. You know, I'm going to ask you to share with, you know, the listeners and everything else. What do you think, you know, I asked you before, what do you think everybody in the paranormal community should know? What do you think is very important in the paranormal community?
Tolerance. I think that the worst thing you can ever do is think that you're right and everybody else is wrong. At the very least, you know, let people be. And really, don't get caught up in the drama, because for every one good person you meet, there's 9 people trying to start drama. The difference is those people are on the keyboards typing while people like us are out investigating. You know, if it's they choose yourself, don't get into the drama. We just don't feed it. You know, I'm not going to feed the fire. I'm going to rise above it. You know, when everything happened a few weeks ago with a lot of, you know, just nasty things, and they were trying to get a response. It was basically they were trying to provoke us. You know, I just said rise above the hate. You know, we rise above it. Just keep your head forward. You almost need to have tunnel vision. Just keep an open mind in the paranormal and keep a closed mind to everybody else, because you're going to discover so much more about yourself and the paranormal by just, you know, not ruling anything out. And that also pulls into not ruling out that something could be explained in a very rational way, you know?
I don't think enough teams try to debunk things anymore.
Well, one interesting thing, you know, and the thing that I don't see a lot of teams do is, like, when we, if we do use the Melmeter, we always take a baseline reading. If somebody had a personal experience, I remember when we had a person, when one of our team members had a personal experience in Ohio, and he was throwing up. I said, well, maybe there's a mold, maybe there's something there. Let's each of us go in there and see if we have an experience, because if it's mold, and we're all getting sick, obviously, you know what I mean?
Of course.
But, you know, be rational, you know, just do what you feel. Be comfortable with what you're doing. As cliche as it is, just be yourself and can't really go wrong.
That's awesome. The very good words of advice. And Dan, you know, I really want to appreciate, you know, I really want to say thank you for coming on and sharing your experiences with us. And definitely, if you guys haven't checked them out yet, go over to YouTube, look up Resident Undead. They have some great clips over there. You know, once again, Dan, thank you for coming on and being my guest tonight, and we will get a hold of you to get together sometime, since you're over in this area now. So
absolutely.
But everyone, I'd like to say thank you for coming out on this Friday evening and listening to me and Dan as well. So we will guys see you guys next Friday with a first hour will be Christopher St. Booth with me.
All right, great. Thanks, General. And just to let everybody out there know, areyouparanormal.com as well, Facebook.com/ResidentUndead, and YouTube, youtube.com/AdamKimmel, K-I-M-M-E-L-L. Everything's free up there. And, yeah, thanks for having us on, Ross. It was nice. I know we've kind of been in contact on Facebook for a while. Good to finally sit down and talk.
Yes, definitely. It was an awesome experience. We'll have to get together and have a beer or coffee or something sometime.
Absolutely. I do all my coffee and cigs.
Awesome, awesome. All right, everybody. We'll see you next Friday, and thank you for listening.
Have a good night.